whole S code will be changed. Let's take one example of SHA-1 S code. So this is the message for that SHA-1 S code. It like this. If you see this, here I have just added one more space between brown and fox. So due to what? Due to these changes, the whole S code is changed. So the only difference between these two messages is like extra space, and due to that, the whole S codes are completely different. SHA-1 produces 160-bit S code, as you can see here, and it takes 40x characters to show the code in the X. So how we can use the S code for the authentication purpose, means for the message authentication. As the first requirement of S is what? It can help to achieve the integrity of the message. Second property, it is offering this message authentication. So there are six different ways to achieve the message authentication over the communication network. So these six different ways are using the combination of the S function as well as your encryption decryption keys. So this is the first method called as symmetric key encryption based schemes, in which from a given message, the hash value of that message is calculated, which is concatenated with the message. And this both message and hash value of that message are encrypted. So at party B side or receiver side, these encrypted values will be decrypted. So receiver will get two things, message plus the hash value. Now receiver will again calculate the hash of this message, and these calculated hash will be verified by this, and then it will be compared. If these two things are compared, if this hash value, calculated hash value, and the hash value within that message are same, that means message is correct. Means here hash code provides authentication, and encryption provides the confidentiality of the message. This is the one way of using the hash for the message authentication. Second variation is that only S code is encrypted, message you keep as like this. It can be used, or it can be efficient if confidentiality is not the requirement for a given application. Means confidentiality of a message is not a requirement, then you can encrypt only the S value. Means from a given message, calculate the S value and encrypt that S value using the like symmetric key encryption algorithm, so both sender and receiver will have same key. So S value will get encrypted, and encrypted S value will be concatenated here. So even if any attacker is trying to modify message or this encrypted S value, at the end this calculated S value and encrypted S value, decrypted S value will not match. So then this message will not be accepted. So in this case, here encrypted S value and message will be concatenated. It will reach to the receiver. Receiver will calculate the S from the given message. Now if you think here, if message is modified, this calculated S value will be different from this, decrypted S value. If encrypted S value is modified, then also it will not match. And if message and encrypted S value both are modified, then also it will not be accepted. So this is how it is offering the message authentication, but not the confidentiality of the message. Then you can use the another version. Instead of using the symmetric key, you can use the public key encryption scheme, and you can digitally sign that given message, so that you can sender receiver side, you can verify that from where this message and S is coming. So this message is there. Message is concatenated with the digitally signed S value. So this S value is digitally signed, and it is concatenated here. Then it will reach to the party B. So receiver will calculate the S from the received message. This is decrypted in the sense whether this S value will be verified using the public key of the sender. So this signature of the given S will be verified. If it is coming from the entity A, if this is verified, then and then only it will be compared, otherwise it will not be compared. So this concept is used while sending message in a blockchain. So while initiating a transaction in a blockchain, this concept is going to be used. Then another version is add symmetric key-based confidentiality. Message, from a message you can calculate the hash value. Digitally sign that hash value, then perform the concatenation, again encrypt it using the symmetric key. So that you can achieve the message confidentiality as well as the message authentication both. In previous case, you cannot achieve the message confidentiality. But here you can achieve the message confidentiality as well as the authentication. In this case, sender is adding the some salt value, kind of some shared secret with the message, and then using that shared secret and message concatenation, the hash value will be calculated. So these two things are the input for the calculating the hash. Then hash value will be concatenated with the message. So message will go here to the receiver. From here, message will be taken and shared secret will be added to calculate the hash. Here shared secret is adding the security of the calculated hash value. But here confidentiality is not there. So authentication is again becoming a stronger here by adding the shared secret. Then you can use the symmetric key based confidentiality which can add to within this. So here too, in previous case, confidentiality of a message was not achieved, but here you can encrypt this concatenation of calculated hash and the message, where hash is calculated by concatenating by taking input of the concatenation of message and shared secret. So when the hash functions secure, so if hash functions are not collusion resistant, then they will come under the birthday attack. What birthday attack is saying that if you use n bit to represent the hash code, then you have 2^n distinct hash value. And as I said that the hash code size is lower than the message size. So if I'm using the m bit message, then I can produce 2^m different kinds of messages. And if I'm using n bit hash value, I can produce 2^n distinct hash values. Now where 2^n will be the lower than the very much lower than the 2^m. Hash scope function should be 1-to-1 mapping, means 1-to-1 mapping of message to the hash code. So that obviously there will be some remaining messages for which hash code can overlap. So and that is called as a collusion among the messages. Means two messages will have same hash code. So collusion resistance refers to the likelihood that two different messages possessing certain basic structure so that to be meaningful will result into the same hash code. Means even though if you are having the two different messages, but those messages are having some structure and based on that you are coming into the same hash code. So practically all the algorithms for computing the hash code of a message view the message as a sequence of n bit. And if you see in CRC, we are using the XOR function to find out the parity bit. So the message is processed one block at a time in an iterative fashion in order to generate its hash code. Simplest hash function consists of with the first n bit block, XORing with the next n bit block, XORing with the next n bit block, as like in the CRC. So this is like a XOR hash algorithm. With the XOR X algorithm, every bit of the hash code represents the parity at that bit position. Thus, the hash code produced is known as the longitude parity check. It can be useful as a data integrity check in the presence of completely random transmission error. So that we have seen in the computer network, that how the XOR S algorithm can be used to check the presence of any error. But how adversary can break such XOR S algorithm? Adversary can modify the main message and add a suitable bit block before the S code so that the final S code remains unchanged. Take the example, X1 to XM are the bit blocks of a message. So, and each block of size is n bit. So your message can be what? Concatenation of X1, X2 to the XM. And consider, now we have applied XOR S algorithm. So X1, XOR, X2, XOR up to XM. That will produce my S code. So delta M is my S code of the S code of the given message M. Now an adversary can easily create a forgery of a message by replacing X1 to the XM minus 1 with any desired value Y1 to YM minus 1. So I am taking Y1 to YM minus 1 and that I will XOR with the calculated S value. So whatever S value was produced by suppose user A, I will take that S code and the M minus 1 number of blocks of that message. Ultimately, I will be able to get YM. So if I will transmit Y1 to YM, I will get the same S code. So forged message will be what? Y1, Y2, YM. This YM I am derived from the given S code and X1 to XM. Therefore, when the forged message is concatenated with the original data M, the recipient would not suspect any fault play. Means, sender can send, instead of X1 to XM, sender can send Y1 to YM, where Y1 to YM minus 1 are randomly generated. Y1 to YM minus 1 are randomly generated, and YM is derived from this Y1 to YM minus 1 XOR with the delta M. Another problem, reducing the collision resistance for the structured document, like one would have that with an n bit S code, any particular message would result in a given S code value with the probability 1 by 2 raised to n. So to increase the space of the distinct S value, what we can do, we have to increase the size of n. So perform a 1 bit circular shift of the partial S code obtained after each n bit block of the message process. So like once I'm processing X1, means first block of the message, whatever S value I'm generating, that I'm rotating. So this algorithm is known as the rotated XOR algorithm. But again, it is a poor, how it can be broken, take a message M1. Along with its code H1, because this is known to the adversary because we are transmitting. If you are applying the encryption on these two, then it is difficult to get M1 and H1. But if M1 and H1 are transmitted over the network only for the message authentication, then this attack can be possible. Then replace M1 by M2 of the S code value H2. Because M2 is having the different S code H2. Replace M1 by M2. Then append a block of some gibberish at the end of M2 to force the S code value of the composite to be H1. You have replaced M1 by M2. Now append the blocks of this M1 at the end of M2 to force the S code value of the H1. So even if M1 was transmitted with an encrypted H1, it does not do as much as good from the standpoint of authentication. Why? Because you have added those blocks. So we have to see that security of how we can consider or how we can derive the security of any S code. It is you can derive claim. Assume that we have a random message generator that through that we can calculate the S code for a given message. Now our interest is to know whether any of the message is going to have its code S code equal to the target S code value. If this is the case, then blockchain mining will not take place. If this is the case, or if this is happening at high probability, then we should not use that S function into the blockchain, because the blockchain in mining, for mining a block, what we need? We need to generate a block in such a way that it should have that S value lower than the some target value. So if you are able to find a message or message for which its S code will be equal to or lower than its target value, and if that probability of finding such message is high, then blockchain can be broken. But let us consider a pool of K messages produced randomly by a message generator. Now the question is, what is the value of this K? Means what is the value of such randomly generated message K, such that at least one message out of this K which will have this target S value with probability 0.5. This is first question. I am considering only probability 5. So how many such messages I should generate so that at least one message from this pool will have same S, given S value. So how we can derive this? So to find K, we can give the region like S code can take n different but equiprobable values. So n is what? Suppose if I am using n bit S value, so my capital N will be 2 raised to n. And when I'm assigning this S particular S code to given message, I cannot assign same S code to the another message. And that is why it is called as equiprobable values. Now pick a message X from the randomly generated pool of K messages. Since all the N S codes are equiprobable, the probability of message X having the target S value will be 1 by N, because we have 2 raised to N number of messages, 2 raised to small N number of messages. That is the pool of S codes. So pool of S code is defined by the N. Now I'm picking one message. I want to derive the probability of this particular message is having this particular S. The probability will be 1 by N, where N will be equal to 2 raised to N. Now the S code, since the S code message X is either equals to H or does not equal to H, so the probability of the message X is having this S code, message S, X is not belonging to this particular S code, that probability will be 1 minus 1 by N. This is how this is 1 minus 1 by N, because the probability of having X to the particular S code is the 1 by N. So I have to subtract this value from the minus 1. So that is showing that this particular message X, which is not having this S code H. If I am randomly picking two messages, X and Y, from the pool, then the S code of neither of any of the messages are having the same S value. What will be the probability? Because these are probabilistically independent messages. So it will give me the 1 minus 1 by N raised to square. Now I am, instead of taking two messages, if I am taking K number of messages, so this will lead to the 1 minus 1 by N raised to K. This probability showing me what? From an entire pool of K messages, no message is having this S value H, means no messages are having this target S value H. So if I will subtract this, if I will subtract this value from the 1, that will show me what? From a given k number of messages, at least one message will have s code equal to h. Now this equation, this expression can be simplified. If a approaches to 0, then we can write 1 plus a raised to m, which will be equal to, approximately equal to 1 plus a n. So this probability expression can be derived by what? 1 minus k n. So it will be equal to k by n. So this k by n is showing what? The probability of a one of the message in the given pool of k messages, that one of the message will have s value equal to the h. Now recall the question one. If I am considering this probability should be 0.5, then how many random messages I should generate? Means I want to derive this k by considering this probability is equal to 50%. So I am putting this 50% value for k by n. So k is equal to 0.5 into n, where n is the pool of s codes, and k is randomly chosen messages. So if I am using the 64-bit s codes, then my n will become 2 raised to 64. So ultimately, I have to construct, if I am using 64-bit s code, I have to construct 2 raised to 63 random messages so that at least one message will have s code h, or means target s code with probability 0.5. Now the second question. So with this we can derive the security strength of the s code. So if I am increasing this n, if I can increase this n, then attacker will have to generate more number of messages. Now the second question is saying, what is the probability that there exist at least two messages with the same s code? This is relevant to the collision. I want to find out the probability that there exist at least two messages with the same s code. So our goal is to estimate what the smallest size of pool of randomly selected messages, so that there exist at least two messages. In the pool with same s code with probability 0.5. So I want to identify the, suppose if I am using the n bit s code, then how many random messages I should generate so that from that randomly generated messages, at least two messages will have same S code with probability 0.5. It can be defined in two ways. Like first is, what is the probability that in a class of 20 students, someone else has the same birthday as mine? And I'm also one of the students out of this 20. So this we have solved, this we have already addressed from this question one. So it should be what? 19 divided by 365, where 365 are my the number of messages, and these are the remaining number of students. So this will be approximately 19 by 365. Now my second question was what? What is the probability that there exist at least two messages with the same S code? So that can be given in terms of, what is the probability that there exist at least one pair of student in a class of 20 will have same birthday, and this is called as a birthday paradox. So the probability of this question can be roughly much larger than the 20 into 19 by 2 divided by 365. That means it is 190 divided by 365. So if I am having n number of students and n bit s value, then it will be what? N into n minus 1 divided by 2 divided by n. This is capital N, where m, it will be m into m minus 1 by 2 divided by capital N. So we'll prove it. So this is referred to as a birthday paradox. So if I want to increase this probability, I cannot increase the number of days. So I can have, I can go for the more number of students. So if I am having the 23 students, then at least two of them, at least two of these students will have same birthday with probability more than 50%. If you randomly choose 60 people, then this probability will be increased. So again, I am giving in a different way that given the pool of k messages, each of which has a hash code value from the n possible such values. So hash code pool will be n, where n will be equal to 2 raised to small n. The probability that this pool will contain at least one pair of messages with the same hash code, which can be given by this 1 minus n factorial divided by n minus k factorial into n raised to k. So this will prove that how it can be. So we'll take two constructs. One is M1. So M1 is that we can construct a pool of k messages with no duplicate s value. This is the one way. The total number of ways we have to find out so that we can construct a pool of k messages with no duplicate s value. Second construct is saying that the total number of ways M2. We can do the same while allowing the duplicates. So if I divide M1 by M2, this will give me what? The probability of constructing a pool of k messages with no duplicates. If I derive M1 by M2, where M1 is saying what? Number of ways through which I can construct the k number of messages without the duplicates. M2 is saying what? Number of messages, number of ways to arrange the k number of messages in such a way that I can allow the duplicates to assign the hash code. So if I derive the M1 by M2, this will give me the probability of constructing a pool of k messages with no duplicates. And if I subtract this M1 by M2 from this one, that will give me what? The probability that the pool of k messages will have at least one duplicate hash code. So we'll find out this, how we can derive the M1, how can derive the M2, then we'll perform M1 by M2, and then whatever result will come, that will subtract from the 1. That value will give us what? Probability that the pool of k messages will have at least one duplicate S value. So for the M1, what we can do, since there are n distinct S code, so we'll for the first message, how you can assign the S code n. So for the first message in the given pool of k messages, what are the different ways to assign the n different S codes n? There are n different ways because you can have choice of n different S codes. Now I'm taking the second message. Already one hash code out of n is assigned. Now for the second message, how many ways? N minus 1. For the second message, I will have now n minus 1 because already one hash code we have assigned to the first message. So for the second message, we will have n minus 1 ways to assign the hash code because we are not allowing the duplicates here. For the third message, it will have n by 2. N minus 2. For the fourth third message, N minus 3. For the fourth, N minus 4. Like this, if I'll go on, I have k number of messages. I want to find out the ways for each message. Without find out the ways for each message, assigning the hash code without duplicates. So for first message, I will have N. For second message, I will have n minus 1 ways. For second message, third message, I will have n minus 2 ways. For third message, I will have n minus 4. So for the kth message, I will have n minus k plus 1 ways. So this M1 is saying what? The number of ways to assign the hash code to the given pool of k messages. So this can be given. So if you again solve this, it will become n factorial divided by n minus 1 k factorial. Now second construct, what we decided, the number of ways to assign the S code to the K messages by allowing the duplicates. So I'm choosing the first message. How many ways I will have to assign the S code? N, because I am having the N number of S codes. So for a first message, I will have N number of ways to assign the S code to the given message. For a second message, as I am allowing duplicates, so I will have again N. So for kth message, I will have again N ways. So M2 is giving me what? N raised to K. M2 is giving me N raised to K, while M1 is giving me what? N factorial divided by N minus K factorial. So if I will divide M1 by M2, I'll get probability of what? I'll get the probability that given out of K messages, that no two messages are having the same hash code. Given the out of K messages, no two messages are having same code, and that probability is derived by doing M1 by M2. So this M1 by M2 is showing what? If you construct a pool of k purely randomly selected messages, the probability that this pool has no duplicates in the S code means no any two messages will have same S code, that can be given by M1 by M2, where M1 was N factorial divided by N minus K factorial and M2 is N raised to K. Now we can make the following probabilistic inference. If I want to find out that at least one pair in a given pool of K messages will have same S code, with what probability? So this probability can be given by 1 minus M1 by M2. So it will be 1 minus N factorial divided by N minus K factorial into N raised to K. So this probability expression can be simplified by again rewriting in that same form, 1 minus n, this n is the what? Number of ways to assign the S code for the first message. So I can simplify like this. So this will be given by, as it is n into n up to k. So I can divide this each n by this. So it will be n by n, n minus 1 by n, n minus k by n. So this will give me what? 1 minus 1 by n into 1 minus 2 by n into 1 minus k minus 1 by n. So I am simplifying this expression. Now we know that approximation is saying that 1 minus x will be less than equal to e raised to minus x. So this is our 1 minus x. This should be less than e raised to minus x. So this can be written in the form of 1 minus e raised to minus 1 by n. So this will be 1 minus e raised to minus 1 by n into e raised to minus 2 by n into e raised to minus k minus 1 by n. And this is the summation of, this is showing the summation of 1 to k minus 1. So summation of 1 to k minus 1 is equal to k into k minus 1 by 2. So again, this expression can be simplified by 1 minus e raised to minus k into k minus 1 by 2. And this n is already there. So this is showing what? The probability that pool of k messages will have at least one pair with the identical S code, means at least one pair will have at least two messages will have same S value or greater than that. The probability can be greater than that. This expression. Why? Because we have considered this 1 minus x less than equal to e raised to minus x. If k is small and n is very large, then again, if k is small and n is large, the approximation formula is saying what? E raised to minus x will be equivalent to the 1 minus x. So this is our e raised to minus x. So e raised to minus x should be 1 minus x approximate to the 1 minus x. So this will be again become 1 minus k into k minus 1 by 2n. This is equal to what? K into k minus 1 by 2n. K into k minus 1 by 2n. Again, so this probability is saying, given a pool of k messages and given a pool of n S codes, where this n will be 2 raised to, when n will be equal to 2 raised to small n. That small n is the bit of the S code, number of bits of the S code. Now recall the birthday paradox which we have seen beginning of this question. We had k equal to 20 students and n equal to 365. Put these values here. So k will be 20 into 90 divided by 2 into 365. So this value will give you that out of these 20 students, this value will give the probability that at this probability that out of 20 students, at least 2 students will have same date, but date with this probability value. Now, I am not interested to derive this probability. I am interested to derive the pool of k messages, because as the attacker is going to generate a k number of random messages. So to provide the security strength, I can consider that at least this probability should be 50%. Now I want to estimate the size of k, that how many number of different messages I should generate so that at least this pool will have one pair with same hash code at probability 0.5. So recall this equation, 1 minus e raised to minus k into k minus 1 by 2n. And I am using this probability 0.5, 50%. So you can simplify by using e raised to k into k minus 1 by 2n, which would be equal to 2. Again, this I am applying the ln. So k into k minus 1 by 2n will be ln 2. So this will be k square will be approximate to the 2 into ln 2n. So again, this approximation is saying that k should be equal to under root n. This under root n means it is 2 raised to small n, where the small n is the number of bits of the S code. So if attacker is generating under root of n number of random messages, then attacker can have a chance that at least 2 messages will have same S code with probability 0.5. So as we know that S code can take on the total n different values, so root n, where if we are using the n bit S code, then our n will, capital N will be equal to 2 raised to n. So in this case, the pool will be 2 raised to n by 2. So consider the case 64 bit S code. Now n is equal to 2 raised to 63. So I have to take the under root of this. So if I am generating 2 raised to 32 random messages, then at least 2 messages will have same S code with probability 0.5. So this is what probability claim is saying. So if I want to secure my S code or S function, I have to choose small n value larger. So if I am choosing the small n value larger, then attacker has to generate more number of random messages so that attacker can be successful with probability 0.5 or less. Now we'll see that how it is applicable to the attack. So this can be applied, this birthday attack can be applied to some scenario. So consider this scenario. There is a Mr. Big Shot with having the dishonest assistant, Mr. Creepy. Mr. Creepy is preparing contracts for the Mr. Big Shot's digital signature. Now consider, Mr. Creepy prepares the legal contract for a transaction. So Mr. Creepy has prepared the legal contract for a transaction for Mr. Big Shot. Now then Mr. Creepy proceeds to create a large number of variations of the legal contract without altering the legal contents of the contract and compute the hash code of each. So means Creepy is having the various versions of the legal contract, or I can say correct contract, like C1 to the CK, and each contract will have the hash code like H1 to the HK. So such variation may be water, because content cannot be changed, only you can add the insert the space or some words, or you can delete the some of the punctuation, or you can perform the slight reformatting of the document so that you can have different versions of the same correct contract. So I have generated the correct version of the contracts. Then Mr. Creepy prepares the fraudulent version of contract with the same tactic. What your tactic that was used to generate the different versions of the correct contract, same tactic will be used for generating the fraudulent version of the contracts. Now Mr. Creepy is having the two types of contracts. One set is a correct version of contracts like C1 to the CK. And another set is the fraudulent version of contract F1 to the FK. Now the question is, what is the probability that the two sets of contracts will have at least one contract each with the same S code? So what Mr. Creepy will be interested to perform the attack, I want to find out the pair among this C1 to the C, among the C set to the F. So from the C and F, I want to find out a pair like CIFJ, so that the S of the CI is equal to the S of the FJ. So if I am able to find out this pair, if I am able to find out such pair, I can replace this correct version with the fraudulent version. So first of all, I want to find out the probability, then that at what probability I will be successful. Then I will find out that how many different versions I should create. So if you assume that all the fraudulent contracts are truly random, then the probability of F1's S code being any one of the n permission S code will be 1 by n. And we know that these contracts are truly random. So we can say that F1's S code being one of the n permissible S code will be 1 by n. Therefore, the probability of that the S code SC1 matches the S code of F1 will be 1 by 2. Because we have total n number of S codes. We have n number of S codes. I want to derive that probability of C1 contract 1, which is whose S code is matching with the F1. So that probability 1 by n. Now I will check for the F2. As the probability that S code H1 C1 does not match the S code HF1 will be subtraction of the 1 minus this 1 by n. This is showing what? That SC1 will not match to the HF1. This probability is saying this probability can be derived by 1 minus 1 by n. If I will extend this region, now for F2 it will be same 1 minus 1 by n. For F3, the probability of matching the S code of C1 with the F1 to FK will be 1 minus 1 by n raised to k. But this is for only first correct version of contract. I have to check for C1 to the CFK. So this will become 1 minus 1 by n k square. Why it is becoming 1 minus 1 by n raised to k square? Because this probability is saying what? The probability that C1's S code is not matching with any of these product version of contract. So this is the thing. Now we have correct version of contracts, how many? C1 to CK. So now I am checking for HC2. Again it will become 1 minus 1 by n raised to k. It will go up to what? 1 minus 1 by n up to k times, raised to k times. So it will become k square. So this is the probability that there will not exist any of the S code matches the two sets of contract from the C1, C2 to the CK to the F1, F2 to the FK. Means if you pick these two sets, then there will not be any such pair exist that HC1, HCI will match to the HFJ. There is no such pair exist. If I will subtract this from the 1, means at least one pair, means at least one pair or at least one message from the correct version of contract, the S of that message is matching with the S of the fraudulent version of contract. So since 1 minus 1 by n is always less than 2 e raised to 1 minus n, so I can simplify this expression into this minus e raised to 1 by n k square. Now again pose this question. I am putting this probability 0.5. This probability is saying what? If I am having the list of correct version of contracts and if I am having the list of product version of contracts, this is the probability that at least one pair, that pair is from the correct version and one value is from the correct version and one value is from the product version. At least one pair will have same S value. If I'm setting this probability to the 50%, then I can derive that how many such a product and correct versions I should create. So this can be given by equal to 0.5 or 1 by 2. So 1 minus e raised to minus k square by n is equal to 1 by 2. So it will be given by e raised to k square by capital N equal to 2. I am applying the ln, so k will be the under root of ln capital N, which will be 0.83 under root n. Now you know that this n is very large. If you take 60, n bit is equal to 60. So this n will be 2 raised to 60. So you can approximate it to the under root n. So it is as like our earlier question, that what is the probability that in given pool of k messages that at least one pair will have same S code. So if B is willing to, or if Mr. Trippi is willing to generate under root n versions of both correct contract and fraudulent version contract, then there is a better than an even chance that B will find a product version to replace the correct version. Means with probability 50%. With probability 50%, the creepy can replace this product version with the correct version. If creepy generating under root n version of both the contracts. So that means if I am using this n value higher, then creepy has to put more effort. So in this case, k is equal to 2 raised to n by 2. So this is called a birthday attack because the combinatorial issue involved are the same as in the birthday paradox. So if you see that same issues are involved into whatever we have seen in the birthday paradox. So note that if I am having the n bit S code algorithm that has no security flaw, then approximate value we have obtained k 2 raised to n by 2. This is showing the security level of any S function. So if I am using the SAR256S, as we are using the SAR256S function in blockchain, what is the security level? If an attacker is generating 256 by 1/2, so that will be 2^128 random messages, then at least two messages will have same S value. So SHA series is providing the secure cryptographically secure hash function, and as I said that hash function is like series of operations function, and your whatever arbitrary length message you are given, which will by taking that arbitrary length message, the hash function will produce the fixed length message. This is forming the basis of the MD5 Whirlpool or SHA series of S functions. So we'll see this in detail. So whatever size of message you are giving, that will be divided into the B bit of block. And last message, if its size is bit B, then we have to add one more block, because the last block should contain the length of the given message to notify that how many bits you have padded. So final block is padded suitably so that it is of the same length of the other block. Final block also includes the total length of message whose S function is to be computed. So that at receiver side, you can derive your message by considering its length. So this step enhances the security of S function, since it places additional constraint on the message, because you are adding the additional constraint of the like length. The structure is consist of the L stages. The structure is consider or consist of the L stages. Each stage processing one of the bit block of the input message. Each stage of the structure takes two input. One is the B bit of the block message and the previous output. So consider any of the stage is taking the two inputs, the previous block's output and the current message block. For the first block, initialization vector is there. Now for the N bit input, the first stage is applied with the special initial vector. So at the end, you will have N bit S value, where N will be less than B. And this function F is called as compression function, which is taking more number of rounds. And SHA is considered secure S algorithm, which is the family of NIST approved cryptography S function. And most commonly SHA S function is the SHA-1. Even though it is broken theoretically, but still it is widely used in many applications and protocols that require secure and authenticated communication, like SSL, TLS or IPsec. How it was broken? The secure SHA-1 is generating 160-bit hash code. So the security level of SHA-1 is the 2^80. So if attacker is generating 2^80 random messages, then there is a probability 50% that at least two messages can have same hash value. So these are the SHA family of the S functions: SHA-1, SHA-256, SHA-384, SHA-512. These are coming under the SHA-2. The message size is less than 2^60 message size, and block in this Rolle-Merkle structure, the block size should be 512. So I will focus on SHA-256 in this session, because this is used in the blockchain. So this whatever size of message you are giving, that will be divided into the 512-bit blocks. So word size will be 32. So it will have word size 32. Message digested 256, the security level is 128. So for an attacker, it is very difficult to generate the 2^128 random messages. That is the security level of the SAR-256. So how it is? A message is processed by the block. As I said, that in SAR-256, the Merkle structure, write Merkle structure will require each block of 512 bit. So whatever size of message I am having, I have to divide it into the 512 bit of block. Now think about first block. So from the first block, my word size is 32. So how many blocks, how many words I can generate from this block? 16. So 16 words I can generate, but I am having the 64 rounds. In SAR-256, the compression function is taking 64 rounds. And for each round, I need the message input. But my input is having how many words? 16 words. And I need to generate remaining 48 words so that I can process the 64 rounds. So first of all, I have to perform the block decomposition. So for each block, M into 0 to 151, because these are the bits 0 to 1. And the size of each block will be 512 bits. So this will have, and I have to generate 64 words of the 32 bits. So how it will be constructed? Initial 16 rounds, the 16 words are generated from this message. So 16 words are generated from the message, and remaining 48 words are generated using this formula. So let's say I want to generate the word means message for the round 17. So word for the 17, where I will be 17, will be derived by the sigma 1 into word of the I minus 2. So 17 minus 2, 15. So 15 word was my message. So sigma 1 into this will be added to the modulo 2^32. So this is addition modulo 2^32 operation. This is WI minus 7. So my I is the 17. I'm generating the next block. So I is the 17. So 17 minus 7, which will be 10. Plus sigma 0 WI minus 15. I will be 17. So this will be W2. And this will be W1. What is sigma 0 function is saying? So what your word value you are giving? So this word will be size of what? 32 bits. So if I'm using this I minus 2, that is 70 minus 2. So I have to take the W15 here. The size of W15, or what all the words will have size 32 bit. This will be given by some operations, rotate R. So this word will be rotated right side by the 7 bit. Whatever output will come after rotating, it will be XOR with the another word, which is this word, 17th word, is rotated right side by the 18 bits. So this will be rotated right side by the 18 bits. The output will be XOR with the previous output. Again, the output derived by XORing these two outputs will be XOR with the shift right side of that word bit by the 3 bits. Means when I'm shifting, see the difference between rotation, and this is circular rotation. And when I'm shifting by 3 bits, so last 3 bits in the right side will be removed, and at left side I'm appending the 0. So this is sigma 0. Similarly, sigma 1 function will be applied, and this is how I will derive the W7. Like this, for each round, I have to generate the message block or word block. Now we'll see the compression function. Now in each round, what are the operations are performed? So consider this is your first round. So which will take three inputs. This first round, all the rounds will take 3 inputs. So consider this is your first round. This first round is defined by 8 variables. So these 8 variables are given by the first 32 bits. 8 variables are set to their initial value given by the first 32 bits of the fractional part of square root of the first 8 primes. So my first prime will be 2. So I'll take the square root of 2. Whatever value will come, I'll take the fraction part of that value and I'll take the fractional part of this value, and from that fractional part I will assign those 32 bits to the A. Similarly, I'll take second, like this I'll take first 8 prime numbers, I'll calculate the square root of first 8 prime numbers, whatever value will come, take the fractional part, and from that fractional part take initial 32 bits. So this is what my initial vector. This is my initial vector, and WI is the first word which I derived from the my message block. First word and KI. So this input key we'll see later. So first, in every round of processing, same thing will be applied. Only thing, these registers are going to be updated. So registers are going to be updated based on some operation. So this is the first round. For second round, this updated registers will be the A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. Same operations will be performed. At that, in second round, this W will be what? Second word, and key will be the second key. So how those register values are updated? A will be updated by T1 plus T2, where T1 will be given by the register value H, addition modulo 2 raised to 32, sigma 1 into E. So we'll see these operations are given by this. So if I want to perform CH, EFG, where E, F and G are the initial value, I'm doing it for the first round. So EFG are the initial vector value. So CH value will be given by the E and Y. So I have to perform bitwise AND operation, and this is bitwise XOR operation, and E bar AND Z. Again, rotate R definitions I have given. So using this formula, in every round, your register values will get updated. So consider, this is your first round. For first round, this was the initial vector. After doing all this process, your second, for second round, this will be the input, because these register values are updated with this by using this formula, and this will be the output this will be the input for the second round. Like this, I have to perform the 64 rounds is SAR-256. The question is, we understood this W, we understood this register value, we understood these operations. Now, how to derive this key? For each round, we require the separate key. So these keys are derived by the 32 first bits of the fractional part of cube roots of the first 64 prime numbers. We have to take first 64 prime numbers. Why we have to take first 64 prime numbers? Because we are having the 64 rounds. Then for each, on each prime number, perform the cube root. You will get the values, take the fraction part. From this fraction part, take the initial 32 bits. And that will be the key for each round. So this is how SAR-256. Now you can imagine that how much computational effort it will take. And that is why mining is also difficult, because every time you have to perform try and error method. At first instance, you may not be successful. So every time you have to change the value of nulls, as I explained earlier, every time you have to change the value of nulls and you have to calculate the S value. If that calculated S value is not lower than the previous S value, then again you have to change the value of nulls and again you have to do this process again. So that is why it is computationally, it will take too much time. And that is why proof of work is computationally costly. So how, so this is, till now we have seen that how S code can be used or how S code can be generated. We'll see the standard secure authentication code, that is the message authentication code. So MAC is known as cryptographic checksum as an authentication code because it is taking the key as well as the S function. So assume that collision resistance S function and original message and its MAC, it can be safely transmitted over network without worrying the integrity of data, without the worrying that the integrity of data may get compromised. So hello. You can, hello.
Yes, sorry sir for interruption. Before we move forward to message authentication codes, we have few questions regarding HES function's strength. Can we take it up?
Yeah, we can take it. Yeah.
So one of the question is the block of chain is shared with, the block of chain is hashed with algorithm X. How can we change the hash algorithm to algorithm Y? How it can be reflected in all blocks?
Let me see that question again. I can see in chat box.
Okay, okay.
The block of chain is hashed with the algorithm X. How can we change the S algorithm to the algorithm Y? How it can be reflected in all the blocks? See, in blockchain, all the nodes will have to follow same structure. Means if one node is using the SHA-256, then all the nodes will have to use same S algorithm. You cannot deploy different S algorithms on different nodes to maintain the chain. Because that flexibility is not offered by the blockchain, and you cannot offer also. Otherwise, the structure of the blockchain, link will be different at each node.
Sir, I think ma'am is asking if all the nodes agree for changing a HES function.
Yeah.
Then how the thing will proceed?
Yeah, then it can be it can be solvable. Then for all the nodes, when they are downloading the code, if you are using the existing blockchain, already these things are fixed. You can download the node and you can perform these operations. But if you are developing your own application, then you can fix this hash code. So in mining operations, you can change the values of this S function, S algorithm, that which algorithm you would like to use.
Okay. Sir, you said that we need to use larger size of hash code so that the security breaches would be less. The probability of getting the pair of messages which will be having same hash function would be less.
Yes.
So, but sir, in that case, if we are increasing hash code size, will miners take more time to generate a block?
Yes, it will slow down the process. So this is a trade-off between process and security. Even I can say that SHA-1 is broken. See, in SHA-1, 2:2, the security level of SHA-1 is 2:80. Means if an attacker can generate 2:80 different messages randomly, then he can have probability 50% to break the SHA-1. But already in theory, it is broken by generating 2:69 messages with probability 50%, means it is already broken. So even the probability claim is saying that it can be possible, but with less number of messages, it can also be possible. And still, it is known that this SHA-1 is broken. Still, it is widely used in many of the communication protocols like SSL, TLS. Still, they are using it because they do not want to. We have to always play between two trade-offs. So if you are increasing the size of this hash code, at same time, you are compromising the speed.
Hmm.
there should be.
Any other question from any other participant?
Yes, Modi sir, advisory, what you have just suggested, can you consider like this? It is something like a bit padding, what we can do in that overall code. And as madam had just said, like by increasing the overall number of bits to be processed, ultimately it will slow down the overall process.
Yeah. But padding means I'm not getting.
No, you were sir talking about the advisory when we are just designing for the hash code and all that thing. So yeah. Advisory, you have said that intentionally we are adding certain bits and which will actually increase the size of that overall bit, which has to be total number of bits which has to be processed. So I think it is something considered like that in CRC, na? Cyclic redundancy code, like it is a some sort of bit padding. And due to which the total number of bits which is to be processed, it will increase. And ultimately, we have to do the trade-off between the speed as well as the accuracy.
Yeah, in computer network, if you see that all the routers and the switches are considered a kind of node which are transmitting data to each other.
Yes.
Same like the nodes into the blockchain.
Yeah.
But in case of computer network, within that protocol, they are considered the CRC with small values at that at router level. That router level processing can be very less. If I will use the SHA function at the computer network, then I will not get the faster network speed. Okay, so that scenario is different. There is, compared to the security, the priority, more priority is given to the speed in case of computer network. And if I want to use the security, data security on the top of such computer network protocol, then I must have to go for the security protocols like SSL, TLS.
Yes. Means like because some sort of data synchronization what we require, na? Some sort of buffering and all such things that we have to neglect when we are considering all such things which is happening at the and computer at, network level.
Yes, and at every node level, there is a checking whether this data is correctly received or not, or is there any error. If error is there, then acknowledge message will go to the receiver, and then again, error checking codes are applied.
Reliability of data that is more important than the overall working speed or the processing speed.
Yeah, so in case of computer network, the major priority is given to the speed, but if you want to give the priority to the security on the top of speed, then you can apply the SSL TLS protocol to provide the information security over the data. But in that case also, you are compromising the speed at some level.
Yes.
So, but in such financial application, we must have to give priority to the what? Our information security.
Yeah, yes.
So they are compromising the some speed, but they are not compromising the security.
Accuracy or security, yes. I agree, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very
much. Sir, one last question. Sir, in one of the slides, you said that for assuring the authenticity between two parties, some shared secret is to be added with a message. But the question is, how to share that shared secret securely between two parties? How they can decide it before they start any transaction?
So, see, you are already knowing that, I can go for the central authority, like certification authority, which can distribute the keys among the candidates to perform the communication. Or I can generate the session key between two candidates, or I can go for the key exchange protocol like DeFi-Hellman key exchange protocol, so that I can securely share the key. Or I can go for the elliptic curve-based DeFi-Hellman protocol, or I can use some trusted server like Kerberos or IKE, Internet Key Exchange Protocols. So there are many key exchange protocols available to generate the to share the keys securely among the entities, so that shared secret can be always available.
Yes, sir. Sorry, I forgot. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Getting so that is a part of symmetric key encryption. Even if you see the SSL TLS, initially they are transmitting one session key using public key cryptography, and then later whatever communication is happening, that is happening through the symmetric key based encryption decryption algorithm.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'll go to the message authentication code. So I'll directly go to the secure message authentication. So that is the HMAC, S message authentication code. So if you see that this is your message, which is divided based on the bits, then IP value K. So just remember this structure in which key, message and S functions are used. So the message is segmented into B bit blocks, like Y1 to the Y0 to the YL minus 1, as like the S function. And B bit, the decision on this B bit is based on which type of S function you are using. If you are using SAR 160 bit, then this B should be 160 bit. But this message is added after some B bits which are derived from the XOR of the IPAD and key value. So we'll see what is IPAD and key value. So K is the secret key to be used for producing the HMAC. As like in DES, we are having the secret key, and from this secret key, we are deriving the further keys. So K plus is the secret key padded with zeros on the left side, so that result is the B bit long. So I am having the secret key, I am padding with the zeros on the left side. So because I have to make the size of this key up to B bit, so I can choose any small key, and I will pair with the number of zeros, and that will be XOR with the IPAD value. And IPAD value is also B bit. So this output, by XORing these two values, will produce B bit. Now this structure is same like the Merkle structure, and I will apply each of the block to the S function. So this S function will generate the N bit S value. Okay. So this N bit S value will be padded to the number of zeros, so it will have again produce the B bit. So up to this, we have to see what is IPAD value. So IPAD value is repeated number of this sequence 00100110 by B by 8 times. Another operation I will perform on key is the OPAD with this K. K is also I have derived from the given K by appending the number of zeros and to make it B bit. So OPAD value will be XOR with the K. OPAD is also fixed 8 bit, but this 8 bit I have to repeat until I'll reach to the size of this OPAD value to the B bit. So I'll repeat this 8 bit up to B, total B bits. So these two values will be XOR, it will produce the B bit. Now these are the two blocks. One block I generated from the OPAD value and my secret key. Another block I generated from my secret key, message and the S function. Again, I will apply the S. So this is the HMAC. So the final S value will be the N bit, and that is the S message authentication code. So the security of HMAC again dependent on the security of underlying S function, that which S function you are using. The size and quality of the key, that what is the size of S function you are choosing, and what is the quality of key. The quality of key like in DES, the weak keys are like 010101. If I am using such keys, I will not be able to produce proper message. So how S function is used into the blockchain? So first I said that S function is used to initiate and broadcast the transactions. So S's are often used in the combination of the combination with the signature. And I have covered one of the method of using the S function for the message authentication, and that was using the public key cryptography. So for example, a certain user is the owner of some input corresponding. Therefore, signature input, you are going to authenticate only the message, but you are not authenticating the S value. So S of the transaction gets generated by user A. So suppose if I I want to perform transaction, I'll generate the S value. And then that S value I'll sign using my private key. So sign S will, L value will be sent to the B, user B, with the public key of your, of the user A. So my public key is known to the user B. User B will get the signed S value. So user B will take the input and regenerate the S value from the sent message. And using a cryptography algorithm, user B will be able to verify the signed S value. And user B will compare the calculated S value and received S value, and verify that user A wants the input or not. So that user cannot repudiate this message also later. This is what transaction signature. And for mining also S functions are used. Mining a block is difficult because the SHA-256 S of a block's header must be lower than or equal to the target in order for the block to be accepted by network. As I have covered in the common workflow of blockchain, the nodes are verifying the proposed new block's S value should be lower than the previous block S value. So the S of the block must start with certain number of zeros. Now the probability of calculating a S that starts with many zeros is very low. As I said that the creating a message whose S code should be target value is very difficult. So to generate a new S each round, a nonce can be incremented because other parameters you cannot increment, which are fixed, whether it is in block header or in the transaction. Only what you can change, nonce value. So a proof of work is a piece of data which are difficult, costly, or I can say time consuming to produce so as to satisfy the certain requirements. So these requirements we'll see. It must be trivial to check. Once that block is proposed or block is generated at particular nonce value, then it should be trivial to check whether this block is having a S value lower than the previous block S value. And how it should be trivial, just other users have to calculate the S value, calculate the S value of the block which they are receiving from the miner. So other nodes will check whether this current block S value is lower than the previous block S value or not. If it is lower, then they will update their own blockchain. They will update their own database. So producing a proof of work can be random process with low probability, so that lot of trial and error is required on average before a valid proof of work is generated. And most widely used proof of work scheme is the SHA-256. Some of the other async algorithms that are used for the proof of work include. So these are also used, these other async algorithms are used not in the Bitcoin but on the other blockchain platforms. So you can go for this. So here see SHA-3 is huge. So SHA-3 is having the bit size more than 1024 bit. So again, they are not compromising the security, but they may be compromising on speed. So you must have to see the application domain requirement, what you need and where you want to give priority. And that is why I said that for blockchain development, you need to understand the software engineering. In software engineering, the first phase is what? Software requirement. And requirements may be conflicting with each other. So you must have to give priority to the such conflicting requirements. So how proof of work is working? So this is the header of the most recent block. This is proposed block and the nonce value. Combine and generate the S value. And if this S value is less than the target value, then whoever has generated or whatever node has generated, they will get some reward. Otherwise, they have to do try and error method by incrementing the value of nonce. Now why we should give the reward? The question is because I said that the network should be reliable. As this node is working for the other, as this node is validating the creating the valid transaction, creating the validity of the transaction, then this node is working for others, so he should get some reward. So if rewards are not assigned, then no node will be active, and finally his network will not be reliable. So today I am stopping here. Tomorrow I have one more session in which I'll cover the different consensus mechanisms, then classification of the blockchains like public private blockchains, then smart contracts, and then we'll see the challenges or security problems in the blockchain. So today I'm stopping here. If you have any question, you can ask me. I'm opening this session for the question answer.
Is there any question from participants? Okay, so we are closing the session as of now. We'll start tomorrow at 11 a.m. Okay, sir, thank you for your knowledge and valuable time.
Thank you.
On behalf of all the attendees, please, sir, I would like